coach.
I wrote Keeping the Faith as a summation of why I wrote the whole Innocent Man album. The lyrics, I think, pretty much describe a style, the way we dressed, the way we acted, things we did at that particular age. This is really a tribute to the music of my teenage years. A lot of it was soul music and R&B and old rock and roll, pre-Beatle music. But I think I even said in the song, the good old days weren't always good, and tomorrow ain't as bad as it seems, so I don't want to wallow in nostalgia.
Oh, $100, thanks.
Keep the faith, kid.
An Innocent Man is reminiscent, to me, of these Lieber and Stoller Drifters songs and Carole King songs about Up on the Roof or Under the Boardwalk or Stand By Me. There's a bass line in it, goes, some people stay far away from the dome when the sun beats down and burns the tar up under the boardwalk. You know, that kind of song. When the night has come. You know, that's kind of a Latin rock and roll type of rhythm. And I loved songs like that. They were so romantic and they were kind of sexy, you know, for that time.
Some people stay far away from the door if there's a chance of it opening up. They hear a voice in the hall.
First two chords are open fifth, second two chords open fifth. Keep the same chords. Okay, girls. Matter of trust.
Live with the fear of a touch.
Does it have a, we have an 11 button?
A Matter of Trust was a straight ahead rock and roll song, guitar based, wrote it on a guitar, which I play real badly.
It's too hot.
It's an interesting vocal approach. I'm not singing it like a keyboard player, I'm singing it like a guitar player. So I sing a little bit differently than I normally would. Well, Baby Grin was written with Ray Charles in mind. Somebody had told me, actually Phil Ramone, that Ray Charles wanted to do something with me. And I said, great, I got to come up with a song that Ray and I can do. What do we have in common? And then I realized it was the piano. That was our, you know, touchstone. And I wrote a song. My baby had just been born, and my baby on the mind. Piano on the mind, so Baby Grin seemed the ideal subject matter to write about. And I got this song to Ray, and I was waiting on pins and needles to see if he'd like to do it. And he called up in the studio and said he really liked it, which thrilled me because he's one of my heroes. And I named my daughter Alexa Ray after Ray Charles. And walked into the studio and recorded it. Originally, we played the piano instead of singing because it was a great way for us to start the communication process instead of trying to sing together, because singing with Ray Charles is very intimidating, because to me the man has the greatest voice in popular music, blues. That's Phil Ramone, yeah. There's Ray, obviously. And he looks just like Ray Charles when you see him. Well, Leningrad is no longer even called Leningrad. It's gone back to its original name, which was St. Petersburg. It was a metaphor, well, at the time for me, the name Leningrad screamed Soviet Union, Lenin. And the song was really about the end of the Cold War for me personally. When we went to Russia in 87, it was still the Soviet Union. In America, they still considered it the evil empire. And it was, you know, a very, very moving moment for me to go there and meet people who were very warm, very emotional, affectionate, welcoming. And this one man in particular who was in the video that we made, A Matter of Trust, it was called, who was always in the front row. He was a clown at the Gorky Park Circus. And met my daughter, and you know, she was thrilled with this guy. I said, I'm not going to be in a war with this guy. I'm not going to kill him. He's not going to kill me. The war is over. There's no Cold War. Now, you have to understand, this is the defining political aspect of my life and everybody else who grew up during the baby boom. The Cold War was almost our whole life. we all thought we were going to, you know, blow up with the hydrogen bomb explosion. And then this war ended for me, and it was a very, very moving moment, and that's really what this song was about. Well, here you go, you know, We Didn't Start the Fire is kind of bookending what the Cold War was. It started in 49 when China went communist, 1949, so Red China is early on in the song. And then you have 1989 is when the Berlin Wall came down. Everything changed. Communism started disappearing from the Soviet bloc nations. And so it was, you know, I turned 40 years old. That particular year, it was very bizarre. It was this, you know, whole dovetailing of events that happened. And it all happened in a rush. The lyrics are sometimes a nightmare to do live. Fortunately, I look down at the audience and I see them singing along. And I'm grateful that they know the words, because I watch them. Because if I drop one word, it's a train wreck and I'm gone. I Go to Extremes started being written when the drummer that I work with, Liberty DeVito, has been with me for a long time now, since 75, I think, sat down in the studio and started to play his drums. It's really driving beat. And he said, can you write something to this kind of beat? And I said, I really like that. And I started writing the song right then. Just as an offset to the rhythm he was doing with the drums. And So It Goes is essentially a song written about a doomed love, a star-crossed love. You know, knowing, and I'm sure everybody's had that, when you go into a relationship that it's not going to last. That's essentially what the song is about. Downeaster Alexa was my attempt to write a real folk song. I didn't want to just write a politically conscious statement. I wanted to write about people in a dilemma, in a situation, a traditional working community of people, which is where most good folk songs come from, whether they be political movements or working class people or, you know, people in trouble. Folk songs get written and endure because the next generation understands the plight, and they understand the feelings, the emotions. So it was my attempt to write a folk song, and it's a different tempo in this song. The accents are on the first beat and the third beat, 1 and 3, rather than the back beat, which is most rock and roll, is on 2 and 4. This is on 1 and 3, so it's almost like a Celtic tribal beat, where I wanted to capture the feeling of people rowing a boat, like the Aran Island fishermen. And the lyric really does tell a story about people who are in a struggle to keep their livelihoods. And it's going on right now in Long Island, all up and down the East Coast and the Gulf Coast and parts of the West Coast. Commercial fishermen are being disenfranchised and put out of business. Shameless was written originally as kind of a tribute to Jimi Hendrix. Where you gonna run to now? I always loved Jimi Hendrix recordings. He had this great, the French have a word for it, insouciance. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. He would go on to chew gum.
Yeah. Well, shucks, is my daddy to see me now?
And I wanted to approach the vocal like a Hendrix song.
Well, I'm shameless.
I even chewed gum.
When it comes to loving you, yeah.
Imagination to do that song. It's all about soul. All About Soul started out very fast, and originally it was called the motorcycle song. I wanted to write a song about a motorcycle. And it was done really up-tempo. And she waves da, 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 da. And I'm on my motorcycle, like, what's the band? The Sultans of Swing, Dire Straits. It was like a Dire Straits kind of tempo. And on my bike or something like that. The lyrics really weren't that good. And I said, well, nothing's going to happen with this. And at the time we were in the studio, the producer I was working with, this guy named Danny Korchmar, he said, might try slowing it down.
I know what you're talking about.
And then we slowed it down, and it got this kind of throb in it when we slowed it down. And that added a certain sensuality to it. And the lyric took on a whole different approach. It was about a woman lying in bed waiting for a man. And I thought it really evoked a great emotion. Lullaby made it possible for me to write the song, The River of Dreams.
In the middle of the night.
The River of Dreams is a play on the phrase stream of consciousness. I started writing these lyrics out of a dream that I had. I woke up and I was going, in the middle of the night. I go walking in my sleep. I said, why am I singing this? I had a dream, obviously, and it had a very strong impact on me. I couldn't shake it off. I didn't even want to write the song because it started out as a three-chord song. I said, I don't want to write this. It's too much like an old rock and roll song. I don't want to do that. I mean, it wouldn't go away. Then I got in the shower. And when you're in the shower and you start singing, forget it. You've got to keep going with what you're doing. So these images emerged from a dream that I had had about baptism and renewal and mountains of faith and the deserts of truth. Hey Girl is a song that I always liked from the first time I heard it. It came out in 1963. I was 13 or 14. I think I probably was going through my first heartache over a girl. And this song was being played on the radio. Freddie Scott was the artist. And there was something so melancholy and wistful about it, it stayed with me.